everyone. I am Rebecca from ChemKnits, and today we are going to start with a little mystery. I have this yarn from Dyer Supplier that is labeled as BFL DK Superwash, 100% Blueface Lester Superwash wool, about 245 yards per 100 grams, and it does not look DK weight to me. The strands of yarn are thin enough that it really looks more like a fingering weight yarn to me. Now, Dyer Supplier did also have a 100% BFL fingering weight yarn, which had approximately 430 yards per 100 grams. I actually have a wraps per inch tool, but I didn't go and get that. Instead, what I did was measure the skein, and it's about 5 feet around, and I counted the number of wraps. And there were 253 wraps here. And so if the skein is about 5 feet, like I measured sort of like around the circumference. If that is true, and if there are 253 wraps, that would be around like 430 yards, which is way more in the range for a fingering weight yarn. Maybe I'd call it approximately 400 yards to be safe, but I am fairly certain that this is a fingering weight, not the DK, and it's mislabeled. I just hope that it's actually superwash. Here's a skein of it that I dyed, and it does not feel like it's non-superwash. It's got like a smoothness to it that I associate with superwash yarns. So I am gonna go with the fact that this is the fingering weight, not the DK, of the BFL superwash yarn. And we're gonna dye some more of it today to leave no dye behind. But anyway, since I was looking at the yarn that I had dyed already and I was like, this isn't looking like it's DK weight to me, I wanted to come and share this. I have one skein of yarn here that has been pre-soaking overnight, and I'm gonna add in this second skein that I'm gonna want to pre-soak for at least 30 minutes. So hopefully it'll be nice and well saturated. But the finished yarn that I had dyed before is beautiful, so I'm excited to dye some more of this, even if this base is no longer available. Today, we are gonna leave no dye behind. We have in here a combination of some browns, some greens that I mixed from some primary colors, and some blacks. And so we're gonna play around with all of this onto the fingering weight BFL yarn in a low immersion steam pan. In addition to using some leftover dyes, we're gonna use a leftover dye bath. The dye bath started with, I would say, I don't know how much water, but about that much water with 4 tablespoons of white vinegar. And it is warm, but not super hot. Like I can have my hands in it comfortably. I'm just spreading out the yarn so we can get ready to add the dye. So everything is warm, but I don't have the heat on right now. And that is partially because, I don't know, I guess I want to be able to manipulate the yarn a little bit as we start adding dye, which is going to be, my guess is it's going to be a lot of green. As you can see from here where we're starting, that's one of the greens, and we'll rinse things out as we go, but we've got a lot more of green from where this came from. The greens are probably going to be somewhat different, but that's okay, but there's still, it's going to be a lot of green. I just rinsed out the rest of those greens into this brown. It is a warmish brown, but it is very much a brown. I think I may also have a cool tone brown somewhere. I don't know. Now, one of these colors may be, well, one of them might be black. This could be the greenish black I had mixed at one point. But one of these colors, I think, is some of my muck dye that has a little bit of all 40 Jacquard acid dyes, but this one may actually be the black. We will see. I'm planning on moving everything through a little bit. I just sort of wanted to see what we were working with here. But actually this one, okay, this one is probably actually the black. Oh goodness. And then I have a little bit of some gray, which ultimately, is just more black.
But then I also have some more green, which I'm going to hold on to for a moment to help move things. Now you'll notice as I'm moving it, things aren't moving very far anymore. I mean, some of it will, like the black here will, but a lot of the colors will sort of stay put a little bit. But we can also take what we have and move it all the way through. And some of these colors will stay where we placed it, but it also will start to blend a little bit and sort of soften. And the water is still fairly warm, but this is a kind of thing I like to do sometimes. Sometimes I've done it in like a shoebox, just to sort of soften things. But since we have a reasonable amount of acid in here already, that's why we do see still some separation of where these different colors are. And I'm bringing in some more of the green onto these areas. And one of the big reasons why I'm moving it through is so that way we're not gonna have to flip this to add color to the other side. Now, on the monitor right now, it is looking a tiny bit muddy, but I did muddy it a bit, and we've got blacks and greens. It's gonna be moody and pretty. Now, I do have some remnant dye in all these cups, and so I'm gonna rinse them, sort of mix that all together. I'm gonna add this to that end, and then I'm gonna come in before turning on the heat, and we're just gonna add a little bit more acid to help things strike. We have a lot of different pigments in here, and I am excited to see where we end up. So I'm now gonna turn on the heat, and we're gonna heat for 30 minutes. It's been 30 minutes, and I'm gonna turn off the heat. And because I have a light on up here, I think that the colors look a little bit brighter than maybe they would otherwise. So I am seeing some green left in here. We did have fluorescent lemon and Caribbean blue in with some of the dyes, and so, but most of the color seems to have absorbed pretty well. I think what I'm gonna do now is, with the heat off, leave the yarn here in the pan to cool completely, so then we can wash it. Let's wash the yarn. I really enjoy creating variegated colorways, especially ones that seem to be relatively saturated like this, using immersion techniques. The problem is that if I go to more skeins in a pan, then I'm not good about increasing the water enough so that way I can get the dye to penetrate through all the yarn as well as I did here. So that's something that I am still working on. I'm seeing a very, very light hint of green in here, but I am not concerned by that. I'm now gonna fill up the basin. We're washing everything with cool water, and I'm gonna add a little bit of some dish soap and finish filling up the basin. All right, let's see. All right, it's about the same, which I'm not concerned with, because if it got more intense with soap, then I would start to get worried or frustrated, but it is just a tiny, tiny amount. I'm gonna go ahead and rinse it a few more times, and then I will check back in. All right, let's take a look. And I'm not seeing any more color come out. So I'm gonna put the yarn through my spin dryer, hang it up to dry, and we'll take a look at the finished yarn. And here is the finished yarn. We do have mostly green, but we have some beautiful hints of some brown and a lot of different greens in here, which is very, very exciting. There were a few requests during the original live stream to just mix everything together in dip dye. And had we done that, we might have seen some really fun breaking or separation of the colors. But I'm ultimately really glad that we ended up here, because I think that this colorway is beautiful and I'd love to create more like it in the future. There's some beautiful depth and dimension in this yarn. It's like a glaze. And this effect that we saw from something like this, that's part of the reason why when I was going back and exploring all different ways to glaze yarn, I realized I should try something colder, leave it in the pot, and then just let it sit and heat up. And I don't remember how cool this was when I started, but not moving the yarn and letting things kind of like slowly come to the yarn but quickly strike give this gorgeous like airbrushed feel that I really enjoy. I am Rebecca from ChemKnits, and if you enjoyed this video, please subscribe, smash the bell to turn on notifications so you never miss a new video, and consider joining the channel, becoming a member to get some other perks like fun ChemKnits emotes and member badges. If you love the yarn I dye and want to bring some home, head over to the ChemKnits Creations Etsy shop. The shop is filled with hundreds of skeins of yarn featured in my videos, and it's another great way to help support the content here. Thank you so much for watching. Guess what? You can pre-order the 2022 ChemKnits Hanukkah yarn samplers now. I am so excited about these colorways I am dyeing up for the 5th Hanukkah special. These yarn samplers have 100 grams of yarn with at least 8 wrapped packages containing yarn that will be featured in a new yarn dyeing video every night of Hanukkah, plus bonus videos and fun extras, a card, lots of fun stuff. These samplers are so much fun and you really should go check them out. They are available in the ChemKnits Creations Etsy shop, and there are also a few full-size add-ons that are still available as well, so you should go check that out. All of the samplers will be shipping in early November, so you get them in time for Hanukkah, and I am so excited for you to see what I'm creating for this year's event.